Christos Anesti. Christ is risen. Can we use this to greet one another during the Holy 50 days instead of good morning, or how are you, Kalimera? We say Christos Anesti. We want to live the resurrection of the Lord, and we need to be part of our daily life. So please, from now on, anybody will say to me good morning, I will not answer him. I will tell him, Christos Anesti. Okay? We are today celebrating the second Sunday of the Blessed Holy 50 Days. The last Sunday, it was the gate for them. The gate was the faith. If you don't have faith, you cannot join the journey. I'm telling you. If you didn't see Jesus, the victorious and the rejoiced, like whom? Like the disciples. When he entered the upper room and they felt joyful because they saw the Lord. Do you share with them this? Are you joyful today? Anybody will be in sorrow? I'm looking at your faces. I want to see joyful face. And the joyful face shouldn't be just a mask. Should be a reflection for a joyful heart. Why? Because death is defeated. Because our Lord gave us victory. No fear from death. No fear from sin, because we can repent and have a new life. And no fear from despairing. We have hope. Why? Because the last enemy is defeated. The last enemy, which is, you know, the strongest enemy, is gone. Now we have the life of resurrection. You agree with me on what I said? You agree? If you agree, let us start our journey. The first thing Jesus want to give us, he want to give us his life. How he can give us his life? There is no other mean. You have to eat him. You have to eat him. That's why the church starts the first Sunday after Thomas Sunday, or Sunday, the new Sunday, was the bread of life. The bread of life. And I want to here today to tell you the truth. I want to change your habits of attending the liturgy. Coming to Sunday to attend the liturgy and take communion and go the same way you came, I'm sorry, will not take you anywhere. You need to know what you're doing. Ask yourself this question. I'm here today to take the blessing of Sunday, or I'm coming here to meet some friends, or I'm coming here because I'm used to this. My parents raised me this way and I have to come. Or I'm coming here to be united, listen to this, with the Lord, abide with the Lord, united with the saints, united with all the people and all the congregation as one body of Christ. I want you to remember those. Those are our three main issues. I'm here today to abide with the Lord. And I'm here to be united with the choir of saints and angels. And I'm here to be united and in communion with everybody. No enemies. We are one body. We are one in Christ. Before we start again, I will ask you a question. Jesus is the head and the church is the body. Have you ever imagined the head can rise and the body stay in the grave? Have you, you can imagine this? No way. So here today, we want to feel that we have this life working on us. Definitely, if I'm going to speak about bread of life, I'm talking about Eucharist. And I'm talking about liturgy. I'm talking about what we do every Sunday. Some people, they come to church, oh, today, well, long liturgy, short liturgy. More hymns, long sermon, all of this kind of nice excuses. I cannot follow, they prayed a lot of Coptic, they play, whatever. I want you to share what the saints who practice this life said. They said the divine liturgy is truly a heavenly service on earth in which God himself, listen to this, God himself, in a particular, immediate, and most close manner, is present and dwells with men, for he himself is the invisible celebrant, You know, the priest who offer is the celebrant priest. No, this is just the seen image. But the true celebrant is the Lord. He is both the offerer and the offering. The offerer and the offering. There is on earth, he is, there is on earth nothing higher, greater, more holy than the liturgy, nothing more life-giving. You agree with me in this? You know how important now? You're dealing with whom? With God. Liturgy itself centered on Eucharist, in which we partake the body and blood of Christ. For this reason, the church places the icon of the, I want you to look here. Usually, we have third icon on top, which is the resurrection. To look to the table where the body and blood of Jesus are there, you have to see the icon of the Covenant Thursday, and on top of it, the crucifixion. Why? Because we cannot enter this gate without the effect of the blood shed, collected in the cup, transformed on the altar, given to the congregation. You follow me on this? And in some churches, we put on top of all of this the resurrection, because some people, they will think, oh, this is a dead man on the cross. No. It's better to have the resurrection on top of all of this. So Jesus, our victorious God, shed his blood, offered his blood, and we partake his blood. My beloved, if it is that good, listen to what is in Proverbs. The Lord is saying, I love those who love me, and those who seek me diligently will find me. There is a difference between coming to liturgy on communion, because we offer now live broadcast and people, they like it, but some people, they abuse it. How they abuse it? They follow us to see if communion started or not. Make sense? This is not right, because if you are invited, you have to attend from the beginning. Nobody can invite you for a dinner and you tell him when you are going to serve the food. This is, you know what it's called. You have to come and join. Okay. I said the first thing we get from this is to abide. And this is what St. John said in chapter 6. Chapter 6 is the chapter we read in Vesper, more Matin, and the Gospel. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him. And I in him. Abides in me. Do you know what does it mean, abide in the Lord? What does it mean? You are not anymore yourself. You are for the Lord. I will give you a very simple example. If I have a very sophisticated machine and I don't plug it, it will work? God created us in a perfect way. But without his life on us, we have no life. We just what? Dust? Whatever you name it. And the Lord, he want to abide with you. See what he's saying in the book of Revelation. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him and he with me. What was here today? The Lord is knocking on our doors. Don't think the door of your home, the door of your heart. He's knocking in your heart today. He's telling, please, stop your mind thinking of so many things and focus on me. Tell me, I love you, God. I want you to have control over my life, because your CPU is your heart. If God controlled your heart, everything else will be good. So today, the Creator offers himself to the creature. The Creator offers himself to the creature. for his enjoyment. In partaking of the body and the blood of the Lord, he abides in us and we abide on him. So if you do this, you can get to number two and number three. Be sure you cannot go to number two without number one. If you don't abide, you cannot be united with the heavenly. You cannot be united with your brothers and sisters in the church, fellow believers. So here, the second thing, we will be united with the saints. What is in the church? There is a cross of innocence the priest prays always in Matin and in the Pauline. And he says, when he looks to the west, peace to the angels, archangels, martyrs, apostles, all the believers. So the church is the embassy of heaven on earth. I used to say that, and some people, they laugh. Sit nicely because you disturb angels and saints sitting next to you. I remember one of the priests who was serving in a remote church, and he doesn't have people coming to church. And he went to complain to his father of confession. I do my best, but people, they don't come. And his father of confession drew his attention to whom he's praying with when he reminded him with the cross of innocence what he's saying. So here today, we are not alone in the church. Don't think when you raise your voice, you disturb a human being like you. You disturb others. Listen to what is in Hebrew chapter 12, verse 1. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great cloud of witnesses, great cloud of witnesses. That's why I can say in Christ's body, the earthly church and the heavenly church are united together. I can elaborate on this, but I will just give you the key. When we pray the commemoration of the saints are still on earth. They are heavenly. Some of the fathers, they used to see them. Every time they mention name, they see them. This means, I don't know, the church went to heaven or heaven came down to church, but they are all united. And the third level, which is communion with the fellow believers. In Temple Epistle, first epistle to the Corinthians, chapter 10, verse 16, he's saying, the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, though many, are one bread and one body, for we all partake of that one bread. And do you know the tradition of our church? Even if we have 5,000 attendees on the church or congregants, how many breads we use? One. And here, if you want to meditate more on this, this bread is made of what? One grain. It's made of many grains. They grind it together. And grinding the grain means subduing it. It's not existing anymore. I can say, oh, I'm a fatter grain. This is not nice like me, and this is whatever. This is what our state now. But when we grind all the grains, can you tell this from which grain? No. And bake it into one bread. And this one bread, redistribute it to many people to unite them and make them one. Ask yourself, you are a grain or a flour? Okay? If you are still selfish, you are still a solid grain. You need the grinder. In his epistle to the Romans, St. Paul said, so we being many are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. Can you imagine? We are members of one another. Where? In the body of Christ. If I am abiding with the Lord, united with the heavenly, united with my fellow believers, then there is another important fact I'm getting from this living bread. which is forgiveness of sin and salvation. Repentance is our return to God. The Eucharist is the healing medicine we need to confirm. We need to confirm that union. The priest, when he carries the plate, he confesses and say, given for salvation and remission of sins and eternal life. How many gifts? Salvation, remission of sins, and eternal life. Do you feel this when you take communion? The same St. Paul in his epistle to the Ephesians and Colossians as well, I will just mention Ephesians. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. But to have this salvation and forgiveness of sins and eternal life, you know, the four important things we have to practice and live with. Number one is faith in Christ, for God so loved the world that he gave himself, his only begotten Son, that whoever believes, the first Sunday, Thomas Sunday, in him shouldn't perish but have everlasting life. Number two is what? Good deeds. I want you to memorize those. Faith, good deeds. The good deeds, talked about it, St. James. But do you want to know, a foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Number three is holy sacraments. And everybody should practice four sacraments at least, which is baptism, confirmation, confession, and Eucharist. The other three are optional, but those are, we call them the sacraments of salvation. Without those, without baptism, you cannot enter heaven. Without confirmation, you cannot be a temple of the Holy Spirit. Without confession, you cannot be forgiven for the sins you do. And the Eucharist, as I said, the medicine to unite you with the Lord. And the fourth criteria here is to believe on the change of the body, the second coming, and the eternal life. And this is what St. Paul expressed in his epistle to the Philippians when he said, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself. If you are united with God, with the heavenly, with your fellow believers, and you are forgiven, do you think you have a mission or you are done like this? You have a mission. You have a mission towards the world. You are not for yourself. And this mission, I don't know what to say, but every liturgy, the liturgy reminds us with this mission, and we recite it very strongly. And we go, nothing. Habit, just as a habit. What is our mission? Number one, before I talk about this, God wants everybody to be saved. In his epistle, first epistle to Timothy, chapter 2, St. Paul is saying, for this is a good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. This is not just personal invitation for you. This is for the whole world. Anybody can remind me where the church reminds us with our mission toward the world and we confirm it? Which part in the liturgy? When the priest says, for every time you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim my, confess my, and remember me, then everybody start to recite, Amen, 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 you're this, O Lord. Very beautiful, nice. And we like everybody to recite it. But what happens? We deal with it as a response, not as a responsibility. There is a huge difference between a singer and between a Christian who united with the Lord and he needs to carry this responsibility. By the way, this part of the liturgy is taken exactly from St. Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians chapter 11, when he said, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Okay? That's why I want to tell you something. You take it to your heart, and please, this is a spiritual exercise of today. When the priest says to the congregation, "Go in peace," at the end of the liturgy, you are sent back out to the world, literally carrying Christ within us. We are sent out to the world carrying Christ within us. This is the state of living the liturgy after liturgy. You know this expression? You live the liturgy after liturgy. Because now we are church time. On church, we have to behave. Outside church, we are different. No. Liturgy, if liturgy, you took the living God, it will be always in you. This is the start of the living, the liturgy after liturgy. We are the people of God performing his work and love and carrying out his mission to the world. If we put all what we said, we reach to the last point, which is the eternal life. Second coming is connected always to the resurrection. In his gospel, John chapter 6, repeated several times, "I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever." There are so many verses. I just want to conclude with this. Remind you, if you came today to church, be sure that you abide the Lord, united with the heavenly, united with your brothers and sisters, no place for hatred feeling. And you are in a state of repentance, forgiven, and you are carrying a mission toward the world, and your eyes focused on the eternal life. My beloved, in the Eucharist, we will find union with God, with the saints, as with each other. Let us not reduce the liturgy to an activity performed on Sunday. Rather, let us carry Christ with us all times, making the liturgy a way of life and a way of love. Can we? A liturgy is a way of life and a way of love, and glory be to God forever. Amen.